of honor, His Excellency President Uhuru Kenyatta, President of the Republic of Kenya, who will be delivering a goodwill address to us. Honorable members, on the sidelines of this session, the Pan-African Parliament, in collaboration with the African Union, will also host the third intergenerational dialogue from the 22nd to 23rd of May, with the theme promoting a culture of good governance for citizens, for the empowerment of young men and women, as well as youth innovation and entrepreneurship. The intergenerational dialogue will create a platform for discussions on the empowerment and development of our young people, and we'll have stakeholders from across the continent, youths, businessmen, elder statesmen, former heads of states. We believe that this dialogue is necessary as we begin to develop the roadmap towards the African Union's Agenda 2063. In the same vein, honorable colleagues, we would, in the spirit of Pan-Africanism, celebrate Africa Day on the 25th of May 2015. This event offers us a unique opportunity as a representative of African people to come together to promote Pan-Africanism, continental integration, peace and unity. We would also, as a theme of our Africa Day celebrations, discuss the empowerment of African women. We believe that Africa needs to create an enabling environment for half of its population, our women, to fully participate and contribute their quota to the growth and development of our continent. Africa needs all hands on deck, and all of us must work together to break those social, religious, and traditional barriers that have kept our women from fully contributing their quota to the growth of our continent. Honorable members, the Bureau of the Third Parliament has enjoyed the full support of this Honorable House. And despite our limited mandate, together we have accomplished significant milestones in the transformation of our institution. We therefore want to use the opportunity to thank each and every one of you for the support we've received, especially towards the adoption of the revised protocol of the Pan-African Parliament by the heads of states and government in June 2014 in Malabo, Equatorial Guinea. I therefore want to encourage all of us to join hands together in consolidating the gains of this third parliament while forging ahead with vigor and robust determination to ensure full and speedy ratification and domestication of our amended protocol, so that we can all begin to take advantage of our enhanced mandate to achieve greater results on behalf of the people of Africa. This will be the challenge that I hope the new leadership that we will elect at the end of this session be focused on and make it an institutional priority of importance. Once again, I welcome you to the sixth session. I solicit your usual cooperation and support as we debate on a variety of issues critical to our continental stability and development. I thank you all for being here this morning as I declare open the sixth ordinary session of the third parliament. One Africa, one voice. Honorable members, in accordance with Rule 9 of the Rules of Procedure, we shall now swear in new members of our parliament. Clerk, you please invite the members in groups.
Thank you, Honorable President. Honorable members, we are going to call the members to be sworn in groups because of the big numbers. So we'll call them in groups of national delegations. So we shall commence with National Parliament of Botswana. And we call the following members to come forward. Honorable Biggie Ganda Butale. Honorable Tato Kwerepe. Honorable Same Mahoa Bachobakaye. Honorable Joseph Mulifi. Honorable Dr. Penyo Butale. From the National Parliament of Botswana.
Mine is in the back. Okay. No, I do have what is in the back.
Okay. Does not have this.
Yeah, she, it's in the back.
Okay.
She took it. She took it and put it in my seat.
Let's read together.
Okay. Let's start.
I Tato Kwerepe hereby swear, declare that I will perform my functions as a member of the African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor, dignity in the service of the peoples of Africa. I will be faithful and bear the allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the protocol to the treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established, and I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
We shall now call the delegates from the Parliament of Burkina Faso. Honorable Pelagi Kabore, Honorable Mariam Wadrowago, Honorable Boubacar Bouba, Honorable Ludovic Dembele, Honorable David Moyenga.
Moi, Bouda Boubacar, député du Parlement panafricain, prend l'engagement solennel devant les députés africains et devant Dieu de m'acquitter de mes fonctions de membre du Parlement africain avec honneur et dignité au service des Africains.
With honor and dignity in the service of the African people, I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union, and I will preserve, protect and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. I so affirm.
Moi, Ouedraogo Mariam,
I, Ouedraogo Mariam, member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnely declare before the African people and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Now we shall call delegates from the Parliament of Congo. Honorable André Obame Itu. Honorable Zeli Pierre Inzongo Masanga. It's Congo. Okay, sorry. We're calling Gabon instead of Congo. Honorable Paulette Mokwegu. Honorable Jean Eyege Ndong from the Parliament of Gabon.
I, Paulette Mungengi, member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnly swear before the people of Africa and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Moi, Jean Yegendong,
member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnly swear before the people of Africa and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights,
international
humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Now we shall call delegates from the Parliament of Mauritius. Honorable Patrice Kesley Amans, Honorable Jean-Patrice France Quirin, Honorable Malini Sewok Singh, Honorable Marie Danielle Selvon, Honorable Mohammad Reza Kassam Utim.
I, member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnly swear before the people of Africa and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Just wait till you're down there.
Moi, Malini Sewok Singh,
I, Malisha Nwaksim, member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnly swear before the people of Africa and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Moi, Mohamed Reza Kassam Utim,
I'm Mohamed Reza Kassam Utim, member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnly swear before the people of Africa and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
We shall now call the delegation of the Parliament, National Parliament of Namibia. Honorable Lloyd Kasingo. Honorable Evelyn Nawases. Honorable Laura McLeod Kachirua. Honorable Mark Henry Vinani. Honorable Bernard Sibalatani. We shall now call delegates from the Parliament of Rwanda. Honorable Jacqueline Muhongayire. Honorable Dr. Jean Nepomucene Sindikumbwabo. Honorable Marie Madiatrice Izibiliza. Honorable Ignatian Nyirarukundo.
chose.
Moi, Marie-Médiatrice Zabirisa,
I am a member of the Pan-African Parliament, hereby solemnly declare before the people of Africa and before God that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the constitutive act of the African Union and the protocol to the treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Now we shall call Honorable André Louis Bernard Poul from Seychelles.
I, Honorable André-Louis Bernard Poul, hereby swear that I will perform my function as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the peoples of Africa. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the protocol to the treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. And I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
We shall now call Honorable Claude Kamanda from Sierra Leone.
I, Honorable Claude Daniel Melville Commander, solemnly declare that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the peoples of Africa. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the protocol to the treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. And I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
We shall now call Honorable Thokozile Angela Matutu from Zimbabwe.
I, Thokozile Angela Matutu, hereby swear that I will perform my functions as a member of the Pan-African Parliament to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the peoples of Africa. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitutive Act of the African Union and the Protocol to the Treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established, and I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God. We shall now call a delegation of the National Parliament of Mozambique. Honorable Veronique Makamo Dlovo. Honorable Jaim Augusto Neto. Honorable Eduardo Joaquim Mulembwe. Honorable Maria Yvonne Renzano Bernardo Suarez. Honorable Manuel Bisopo.
prochaine fois à la question.
Eu, Maria Ivone Ransom Bernardo Soares, desempenharei as minhas funções como membro do Parlamento Pan-Africano com toda a minha capacidade,
com honra e dignidade, to the best of my ability and with honor and dignity in the service of the African people. I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the African Union and will preserve, protect, and defend the constitutive act of the African Union and the protocol to the treaty establishing the African Economic Community relating to the Pan-African Parliament as by law established. I will promote adherence to the principles of good governance, democracy, human rights, international humanitarian law, peace, stability, and all objectives of the Pan-African Parliament. So help me God.
Excellencies, honorable members, let me, on behalf of the Bureau and members of the Pan-African Parliament, very warmly welcome our returning members and our new members who have just been sworn in this morning. I wish you a pleasant stay as you make your contributions to the growth and development of this institution for the benefit of the people of Africa. But we'll give them a round of applause. Honorable members, in accordance with provisions of our rules of procedure, Rule 38(1)(h), it is with great pleasure that I now invite the following guests into the chamber. I invite Mr. Theodore Seki Kubu, representing the Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy. May I also invite the Honorable Cecilia Barbara Atim Ogwai, representing Her Excellency, the Speaker of Uganda. Members, may I, on your behalf, invite one of our own, another of our own, the new Speaker of the Parliament of Namibia, His Excellency, the Honorable Peter Kajabibi. Again, on your behalf, I also invite the new Speaker of the House of Parliament of Sierra Leone, one of our own, Honorable Sekou Doumbouya. We are living in very interesting times, and it's good for Africa. Honorable members, may I, on your behalf, invite Her Excellency Norma India Mfekeko, the Deputy Minister of Department of International Relations and Cooperation of South Africa. Members, Your Excellencies, let me use the opportunity to recognize ambassadors, members of the diplomatic corps, representing various countries. I have a long list here. Please pardon me if your country is not mentioned. The Cameroon, Mozambique, Zimbabwe, Burundi, Uganda, the Yemen, Senegal, Indonesia, Singapore, and many other countries represented by other staff of their embassies. You're please welcome to the Pan-African Parliament and to our opening ceremony. Let me also specially recognize the presence in the gallery of my dear wife, Lady Mabel Iguinedion, who is here with us. Honorable members, May I now, on your behalf, invite to the podium to deliver his message of solidarity on behalf of the Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy, Mr. Theodore Seki Kubo.
Mr. President, honorable colleagues, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I'm conveying greetings from the leadership of the Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy, the Secretary General, Mr. Ioannis Amanatidis, and the President General of the Assembly, Mr. Sergei Popov. The Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy follows with particular interest the work of the Pan-African Parliament and the progress made on matters of parliamentarianism and democracy. We are convinced that the Pan-African Parliament can and must become an example of mature parliamentary function and democracy throughout Africa, as well as a model of raising awareness among citizens and political parties on essential issues concerning the peoples of our continent. Members of Parliament, these last years, we are witnessing manifestations of religious fanaticism and fundamentalism on our planet, and with great sorrow, concern the obligation to spotlight and condemn them. This cannot go on, and the great responsibility lies with all of us, as well as religious leaders, especially of the major monotheistic religions, which we consider to be religions of peace and reconciliation. Actually, it appears that the only thing we can do in our capacity as parliamentarians is to spotlight and condemn acts of vandalism, offense against human dignity, bigotry, xenophobia, and acts that threaten people. The Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy always does so and always issues relevant documents and statements. We are pointing out with great concern and sorrow that the last years, such acts are targeting against Christians in an effort to wipe them out from the areas they've been residing in for thousands of years. Our view is that we should not just limit ourselves to condemnations. We need to act dynamically by taking initiatives and proceeding swiftly to talks with other religious leaders of continents of major monotheistic religions. We have to invite them here in our seat in order to listen and talk with them. We ought to make a joint effort to identify the causes of violence, barbarity, and xenophobia in our religious field and discuss together the ways and means to reduce and eliminate such phenomena. We members of Parliament, vehicles of expression of people's sufferings, must show today's society that we are against any form of violence, especially religious violence, that we become vectors of social calm, serenity, and peace to our peoples. Mr. President and members, the Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy is ready to respond to this challenge and collaborate with Pan-African Parliament. I thank you, Excellency, and honourable members.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that message from the Inter-Parliamentary Assembly on Orthodoxy. Well, thank you. Honourable members, may I on your behalf invite to the podium the Honourable Cecilia Barbara Atimogwa, representing the Speaker of the Parliament of Uganda.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the President of the Pan-African Parliament, Honorable Bethel Nemeka Amadi, my dear brother, the PAP Vice Presidents, members of the Diplomatic Corps, and former colleagues, members of the Pan-African Parliament, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I bring you greetings from Uganda and from the Speaker of Parliament and the entire leadership of Parliament. And I bring you wonderful sunshine from Uganda, the part of Africa. I'm honored to be here and to be part of the ceremony of the opening of the sixth ordinary session of the third parliament of the Pan-African Parliament. I was here when the current leadership was elected. I was here to participate in the first ordinary session of the third parliament. I wish to thank the President of the Pan-African Parliament, Honorable Bethel Amadi, the Bureau, and members of the Pan-African Parliament for inviting my speaker, Honorable Rebecca Kadaga, to give a brief message on this occasion. I stand here today not as a former member of PAP, but as a representative of the Speaker of the Parliament of Uganda, but I cannot hide my emotion to make this presentation in Idris Ndebe Musa Plenary Hall. The name that was unanimously adopted by the plenary when I moved a motion to pay tribute to my dear brother and friend, former President Dr. Idris Ndebe, who died in an accident soon after handing over the instrument of power to the new president and also fully participating in the meetings of that session. May his soul rest in peace. Let me start by re-emphasizing the dream of Africa as a continent, which Pan-African Parliament stands for. That is continental unity of focus, continental unity of purpose, and continental unity of vision in all these struggles to have shared framework which could be addressed by the common social economic concerns of this parliament. I commend the efforts so far made to transform the status of Pan-African Parliament from consultative and advisory role to a legislative body. I congratulate you for this achievement. Africa has a lot of potential to offer its own homegrown solutions to its own problem. The only problem is that the continent's efforts are fragmented and disjointed within the confines of individual, national and regional, social, economic and legal regimes and policies. So PAP, as a continental legislative body, will no doubt offer a powerful clearinghouse to harmonize laws and policies in Africa. This in itself would be an anchor to the unity and stability Africa is yearning for. Before I highlight a few challenges facing the continent at the moment, allow me to address a matter of urgency. Allow me write, Honorable Speaker, President of the Pan-African Parliament, to join the Parliament in condemning the events unfolding in Burundi, which is my own continent, my own sub-region, and also the events of xenophobia taking place in South Africa. I stand with you in solidarity on those issues. On other challenges, Your Excellency, first, much as Africa countries share borders and enjoy geographical proximity, it is ironical that there is a very limited connectivity in terms of infrastructure. It is a common occurrence that one connects to another African country by first flying miles and miles to Europe, then connect back to Africa. This phenomena is demeaning and calls for Africa to refocus
and reassess its social economic models with a view of building intra-African cooperation and collaboration in its true sense. Africa must develop its own economic model and implement it. Don't wait for foreigners to design the model for us. Secondly, we are now talking of post-millennium development goals, which are being reviewed into sustainable development goals. This requires an African platform to enable Africa reposition itself to take maximum benefits from this global policy moment and sway the outcome of the dialogue on socio-economic benchmarks to African realities. This is a further pointer to the enhanced role of a continental think tank now taken by Pan-African Parliament that should be built by you, the Parliament of Africa. Thirdly, whereas the continent has witnessed phenomenal progress in some countries on the question of opening more space for women in national leadership structure like parliament and cabinet, and some countries like Rwanda and South Africa need to be congratulated in a special way for the tremendous achievement they have done in that gender agenda. However, some countries have a very embarrassing state of affairs, where in one parliament, you find only one or no woman at all, and in the cabinet, none. It is still a reality in our own continent in this season. This calls for Africa to collectively re-emphasize, recommit itself to the campaign to open more space for women in leadership. Women can and have been making fundamental contributions to this continent in complementing efforts of male counterparts. As Africa, we need to embrace the theme of this year, Women's Day, that is, women empowerment and development. Let it not just empty words. The spirit in this theme is very relevant for Africa, especially for our desire to open more space for women if the post-millennium development goal are to succeed in transforming the life of rural women and children. Fourthly, as already stated by the president of Pan-African Parliament, Africa is faced with teething problem of unemployment of the youth. Large armies of the youth are wandering the streets after the university looking for jobs which are not available and are not even planned for. The effects of which is social unrest and rising level of crimes. So what would Africa collectively do in its demographic policies, its training policies, and its economic policies to address this? It is an area, again, that requires comprehensive continental framework and coordinated efforts which PAP could spearhead to give priority focus in collaboration with other continental bodies. The strength of a continent is determined by the equality of human resource. So our training policies, human development, and empowerment programs should be well focused and harmonized at continental level. PAP can effectively take up this task to ensure that our primary products are not exported unless they are processed. And our unlimited resource of land is not grabbed by so-called investors, but must be utilized to deploy our youth. Finally, as I conclude this message of solidarity, I wish to call upon members of PAP to be disciples of preaching the gospel of love for the continent, commitment to help one another in the continent, and the spirit of staying true to the cause of Africa collectively, and also staying true to the cause of our nation, which are the building blocks. It is for this reason that Uganda is willing to sacrifice its scarce resources, including human lives, for the sake of restoring stability in Somalia and South Sudan. I wish to challenge the African leaders, including you and me, at whatever level of leadership and responsibility, we need to do deep soul searching and to ask ourselves, are our intents and purposes fulfilling the aspirations, the hopes, and needs of our people? Quite often, we lack the commitment, consistency, and will to fight for and give priority to public interest in our areas of responsibility. That is why corruption has become institutionalized in many African countries, and land grabbing a lucrative venture, in some cases, in collaboration with those in leadership. We must start by condemning ourselves for being self-serving, parochial, instead of putting the interests of our nation and that of our continent and that of the people we lead first. To me, as an individual, the for us to apply our minds, souls, and hearts as a continent. While we beg for donor funding, we cannot hide the fact that some African leaders hold fat accounts in foreign banks. It is a reality. I wish to thank you for offering me, through my speaker, the opportunity to share with you my message of solidarity. I wish you a fruitful session. May God bless Pan Africa. May God bless the continent. And I say all this for God and my country, Uganda.
Thank you very much, Mama Celia, for that very eloquent message, and nothing less was expected from you. A round of applause for her, please. Honorable members, let me state that the Pan-African Parliament, as an institution, has continued to grow from strength to strength. Today, on the African continent, we have three former members who are heads of states and presidents of member states of the African Union in Ghana, in Mali, and now in Namibia. We have vice presidents, and we have now many speakers and heads of national legislatures. Let me therefore, on your behalf, warmly welcome one of our own, now Speaker of the Parliament of Namibia, His Excellency Peter Kajavivi.
Thank you very much. It looks like a full house. Thank you very much, Your Excellency Bethel Amadi, the President of the Pan-African Parliament, fellow speakers here present, Honorable Deputy Minister for Department of International Relations and Cooperation of South Africa, honorable members of the Pan-African Parliament, members of the diplomatic corps, distinguished invited guests, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to be here to attend the sixth ordinary session of the third Parliament of the Pan-African Parliament. And I bring To all of you, warm greetings from Namibia. I take this opportunity to especially welcome the new members of the parliament, including those from my own country, Namibia, as well as also welcoming those who are returning, former members of this house. In the same vein, also saying farewell to the outgoing of this house. Let me reiterate that the Pan-African Parliament is one of the roofs that represents all our various national parliaments on the African continent. This in itself carries a lot of significance in shaping the agenda of this honorable house. It is also there to link us as various parliaments together so that we better strengthen and consolidate our national and continental development agendas, the welfare of our citizens, as well as shaping our national, regional, and continental foreign policy with our development partners and the various continents. Ladies and gentlemen, Africa has a lot of challenges. Our forefathers and some of us diligently ensured that Africa attain freedom and independence from colonial oppression. However, the continent still has to conquer the economic war along with its social and economic challenges, challenges that are found around poverty, income inequalities, food and nutrition security, freshwater security, social strife, and Yuhan area, a number of countries that are affected by current instabilities and all sorts of strifes, health security, environmental health related, and climate change, to mention but a few. We need to address these challenges to ensure a better future for the present and future generations of our citizens on the continent and its island states. Honorable members, we salute our brothers and sisters in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea for having weathered the storm of Ebola epidemic. We would like to extend to them our deep felt condolences for the loss of life suffered during that terrible epidemic. Likewise, we appreciate the support and solidarity extended to them by the rest of the international community for having sent logistics and specialized medical personnel to help tackle these challenges in those sister countries. Honorable members, distinguished guests, I feel honored to have diligently served this house as part of the Namibian delegation and as the vice chairperson of the Pan-African Parliament Committee on Rules and Privileges, and to address you now as an outgoing member. Indeed, the Pan-African Parliament has championed the cause of the continent. During my service here, we together as an institution were able to produce the Pan-African Strategic Plan covering the period of 2014 to 2017, the Code of Conduct for our members, as well as kickstart the process of transforming the Pan-African Parliament into a legislative body, especially on modern law. For example, the Pan-African Parliament has an obligation to come up with a modern law to facilitate the smooth regional integration, as well as putting the Parliament on the map of the continent as an important instrument that helps to bring all of our countries together at the parliamentary level and to shape the future of the continent. The process of transforming the Pan-African Parliament into a legislative body is still ongoing, and I take this opportunity to encourage the incoming team to carry on the pattern and the button from where we have reached. I pledge now and then to continue to work closely with the Pan-African Parliament in our various capacities, although not necessarily as a serving member, but of course strengthened by the fact that our Parliament is fully represented in this House, as witnessed this morning by the swearing in of a formidable team that will continue the work of the Pan-African Parliament. Honourable members, distinguished guests, in the same vein, we are championing the cause of transforming the SADC Parliamentary Forum from its current status to that of a regional parliament, hopefully in the near future. We have a clear mandate as far as the SADC Parliamentary Forum to move that body into a regional parliament without necessarily infringing upon the sovereignty of member states. Already, I am making a plea to my colleagues within the SADC region to engage in this important agenda. If we can borrow a leaf from our neighbors, particularly in East Africa and West Africa, where they have made a great deal of progress as far as regional parliaments are concerned, we can do likewise in this part of the continent. We are determined to do so with the help of everybody to ensure that we advance the agenda of regional parliament. Therefore, the SADC region could also borrow the leaf from other good examples that I referred to. On our current agenda, the African Union has a very clearly articulated agenda represented by the Vision 2063. This is a document that we regard as a roadmap for the way forward for our continent. I'm making a special plea to our various national parliaments to liaise closely as we progress with this important African Union agenda 2063. In this regard, the Pan-African Parliament is well positioned to continue to play a critical role in exercising its oversight responsibility. Colleagues, we have what I can only describe as unfinished business with respect to the question of decolonization of Western Sahara. We must collectively continue to work hard for the freedom and independence of our sisters and brothers in that part of the continent. This is very important. We cannot let up, but we must persist to demand what is rightfully the inalienable rights of the people of Western Sahara. Having said all these few words, I wish the Pan-African Parliament and its leadership all the best as we continue to tackle our regional and continental challenges, holding the banner of our motto, One Africa, One Voice. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, for that message. Our members, let me recognize the presence in the gallery of the High Commissioner of Nigeria. As I now, on your behalf, invite His Excellency, the Honorable Sheku Badara Bashiru Dumbuya, Speaker of the House of Parliament of Sierra Leone. Mr. Speaker, you have the podium.
Your Excellency, the President of the Pan-African Parliament, Honorable Bethel Nnamdi Amadi, Honorable Members of the Pan-African Parliament, Excellencies, distinguished guests, invited delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Before I begin the expression of those thoughts which I deem appropriate to this moment, I want to avail myself of this opportunity first to extend my profound gratitude and appreciation to the President of PAP and the Bureau for the singular honor accorded me in inviting me to be here this morning. Next, I would want to thank in a special way the Honorable Bethel Amadi, the President of the Pan-African Parliament, the Vice Presidents of the Pan-African Parliament, Honorable Members and staff of this institution for the effusive praises they heaped on me by way of very warm congratulatory messages on my election a little over a year ago as Speaker of my Parliament, that of the Republic of Sierra Leone. I became a member of PAP under the presidency of Honorable Dr. Gertrude Mongella. Then PAP was relatively in its infancy. But this notwithstanding, her tenure was not uneventful, since by dint of sheer hard work and dedication, she helped to lay the solid foundation on which her successors have been building to this day. Before I was elected Speaker, I served as a member of PAP under the presidency of Honorable Bethel Amadi. But before Bethel Amadi became president, he had served as first vice president representing the Western region where I incidentally hail from. I must say it here that it was from his tenure as vice president that some of us had seen in him the potential of a future president of PAP. That is why we are not much surprised see that since he assumed the mantle of leadership of this parliament, he has been doing remarkably well. Suffice it to say that his stewardship has been a catalogue of success, a success catalogue that is too bulky to be discharged by enumeration. I congratulate you most heartily for taking power to such a lofty height. The founding fathers of our Continental Union desired that this parliament would be the meeting point of all African people, a common platform for the peoples of Africa and their grassroots organizations to get more involved in discussions and decision-making on issues facing the challenges of Africa. Mr. President, Africa's voice and participation in the process that will shape the UN development agenda beyond 2015 is of vital importance. This August Assembly has a critical role to play in mapping out Africa's position in the crucial global debate. Mr. President, the entrenchment of a democratic culture on the continent remains essential to our aspirations for the creation of a prosperous African continent. It is against this background that I will encourage this Parliament to play an active role in steering discussions and making all necessary efforts in conflict resolution aimed at curbing coups and wars in Africa. Mr. President, Salon is one of the 17 African countries that have completed the assessment process of APRM, African Peer Review Mechanism. This is an indication that Salon has opened up the political space for citizens' participation in policy debates, national dialogue, in these institutional and policy innovations, and to demystify and clarify complicated issues of governance. Mr. President, since the establishment of PAP in March 2004, the Pan-African Parliament has registered a profound record as one of the key organs of the African Union, with the capacity to participate and contribute effectively in discussions aimed at shaping the future of the continent. I commend the AU for adopting the protocol for the transformation of PAP into the legislative body of the African Union. During the Heads of State AU summit in Malabo, Equatorial Guinea, the revised protocol was adopted by the summit, transforming PAP from an advisory and consultative body to a legislative organ of the African Union, with a clear mandate to propose draft model laws, although such provision is contingent on 28 ratifications by member states. This is something we in PAP have been campaigning for vigorously over the years, and now that it is to become a reality, I want to say how palpably excited I am at such a wonderful achievement. Mr. President, my country, Salon, was struck by Ebola in May 2014. I wish to make it known to this House that the government and all stakeholders have been working assiduously and relentlessly to reduce the rate of infection. It is my pleasure to inform you that Salon has been registering zero Ebola cases for days, while a robust post-Ebola response strategy is being elaborated at both the national and Mano River Union levels. Mr. President, before the outbreak, Salon was one of the fastest growing economies in Africa, but this disease has affected most of the development sites of the country. Lamentably, many of our African brothers banned flights to this country and other affected nations. This is in dramatic opposition to what unites all of us as a family of Africa. The action is most regrettable. However, we appreciate the efforts of the international community, the AU, and all those countries that have come to our aid during this sad chapter in our history. Very soon, we'll be saying goodbye to Ebola in Sierra Leone. Mr. President, even though we owe our freedom to our founding fathers, the Pan-African Parliament today represents a significant step towards the promotion of the practice of democracy in our continent. As a former member of PAP, the ideas of Pan-Africanism remain embedded in my heart, and we can be rest assured that Salon's high-quality representation in PAP does not end with the 5 MPs from our Parliament. But all eyes are turned towards the Parliament, hopes are raised in this Parliament, and our national parliaments are inspired by this Parliament. The African youth who are inspiring to build Africa with one voice are listening to this Parliament. That said, this Parliament should not disappoint the people of Africa. Mr. President, at this juncture, and with your indulgence, I would now want to advert to a particular class of people who, in my view, have been neglected, disregarded, and marginalized for too long, but whose distinct capacity and ingenuity should be utilized if Africa is to develop at the pace and intensity we also fervently desire. Mr. President, I refer to the women of Africa. African women can be strong-willed. They are mortals of steel that can resist the greatest temptation imaginable. They are our ideal and therefore inseparable partners of growth and development. The wisdom of man depends on the cultivation of the minds of women. Mr. President, Excellencies, I'm one person who feels strongly and passionately that if Africa is to take her rightful place in the Committee of Nations, and if the economic growth and prosperity of Africa is to be assured, women have to be involved in all aspects of political administration of the continent. If we are to forge ahead as a continent, we must make it as a priority in our agenda for advancement, the empowerment of women. Mr. President, I have faith in women. As Hargreaves said, and I quote, women are the terrestrial planets that rule the destinies of mankind. Mr. President, there is a woman at the beginning of all great things in this world. There are those who say and believe, including my very self, that the quick decisions of a woman without conscious reasons are frequently far superior to a man's most careful deductions. Mr. President, it is my view that no amount of preaching, exhortation, sympathy or benevolence will render the condition of our working women that what it should be, so long as the kitchen and the needle are substantially their only resources. This is the more reason why women of substance have to be part and parcel of state administration. We need their judgment. We need their grit and resilience to make things happen in our continent. Mr. President, if we would know the political and moral condition of a state, we must ask what rank women hold in it. For I believe that their influence embraces the whole of life. Mr. President, I'm at this very instant reminded of the words of a former First Lady of the United States of America, Nancy Reagan, who said, and I quote, "A woman is like a tea bag. Only in hot water do you realize how strong she is." Mr. President, it is only when we put women in positions of trust and responsibility that we will know how strong and effective they are. Mr. President, today we all should be proud in celebrating the fact that Africa has now been making tremendous and impressive strides on the world stage in many respects, but more particularly in the area of democracy and good governance. This is clearly borne out in the fact that in elections that have taken place in parts of Africa generally, the process has been openly acclaimed even by international observers as credible, transparent, and relatively violent-free. We are now demonstrating to the rest of the world that we in Africa can now conduct our affairs politically and otherwise in an atmosphere of peace, probity, and stability. Unlike what used to happen some years back, we now see defeated incumbent presidents graciously conceding defeat to their opposition opponents and heartily congratulating the latter in the process. All this is testament to the fact that Africa has now grown tall in political maturity and is now more capable than hitherto to chart its own course. Mr. President, Excellencies, in my introductory statement, I had said that because so much has been achieved under the administration of President Bethel Amadi, I wouldn't want to enumerate these achievements. But in paying tribute to Honorable Amadi as he comes to the end of his tenure as president of PAP, I'm constrained to mention two or three of such accomplishments which I think are prominent and therefore worthy of mention. These are the amendment of PAP protocol, transforming this body from an advisory and consultative organ to a truly legislative body, increased committee participation at both regional and international meetings, increased election observation missions of PAP, and what is considered by both, if not all, as immensely appreciable is the successful negotiation of an insurance scheme for MPs who are on PAP assignment in South Africa, and which is now fully operational. Excellencies, members of PAP, because of such incalculable achievements, all of which I cannot itemize because of time constraints, I am sure when future historians shall come to chronicle and evaluate the events of the Pan-African Parliament from its inception to date, the name of Bethel Nanumeka Amadi will stand out like a cluster of an untarnished gem sparkling and scintillating against the black background of the Pan-African Parliament. Honorable members, I thank you all for your attention, and may God bless Mother Africa. One Africa, one peace.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Your Excellency, Honorable Dumbuya, I can see you got a standing ovation from the women of our parliament. I'm in total agreement with you. As I now, on your behalf, invite to the podium Her Excellency Noma India Mefelketo, Deputy Minister, Department of International Relations and Cooperation of the Republic of South Africa.
Honorable President Amadi, President of the Pan-Africanist Parliament, and members of the Bureau, honorable national speakers from national parliaments from around the continent, honorable members of the Pan-African Parliament, invited, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Mr. President, allow me on behalf of the South African government and indeed the people of South Africa to warmly welcome you all to our country. It is our sincere hope that the African people, for whom you carry huge aspirations, will together march towards the realization of the African dream as espoused through the continental agenda adopted by African heads of states and government, the Agenda 2063. A lot is expected from this august body of the African people. And I believe that the Pan-African Parliament, in your able hands, Mr. President, is well suited to discharge its task. As for the South African government, we remain committed to continue to host and support the Pan-African Parliament. Efforts are afoot by government to explore the best possible way to allocate a permanent precinct to the Pan-African Parliament and other sister organs like NEPAD, the APRM, AFCON, and PAO. Mr. President and honorable members, we wish to congratulate and thank you for your sterling leadership displayed during your tenure and your selfless commitment in the execution of your task in this office. I join others as we wish you and others well as you embark on your new journey. As we're all aware, South Africa will host the African Union Summit in June 2015. In terms of a decision of AU Assembly of Heads of State and Government adopted at its Addis Ababa meeting in January. This will be the second time in the life of the Democratic South Africa that we have the honor to host an AU summit. South Africa hosted the inaugural summit of the AU in 2002. The June 2015 summit will maintain the theme of the January 15 summit, which is Year of Women Empowerment and Development towards Africa's Agenda 2063. As we look forward to the implementation of Agenda 2063, issues negatively affecting women and the girl child in the continent will be dealt with, and in our lifetime, we can attain women emancipation and empowerment. We hope that the Pan-African Parliament, through its subcommittees, will contribute into this important debate, marking 20 years of the Beijing platform and its implementation plan. Let us all join and take stock of the and place women empowerment at the top of our agendas, both our national and continental agenda. It is gratifying to note that the AU summit in January 2014, the Executive Council adopted a decision declaring 2016 as the Year of Human Rights in Africa, with special focus on the rights of women. Furthermore, the summit will substantively focus on the implementation of a number of decisions taken at the January 2015 summit, which relate to Agenda 2063 and its first 10-year implementation plan, state of continental peace and security, including terrorism, women empowerment and development, alternative sources of funding, the African Union, continental integration, and operationalizing the African Center for Disease Control and Preventative Prevention by 2015. Mr. President, honorable members, the events of the past weeks in our country left a bitter taste in our mouth. We all witnessed acts of wanton violence meted by brother to brother, all because they were non-nationals and perceived to be responsible for non-availability of jobs in South Africa and also responsible for all social ills and contestation for scarce resources. This, of course, is rather simplistic and opportunistic. We admit that much needs to be done. In our country, we still have many, many challenges. And where such attacks happened, we acknowledge that there's lots of service delivery and creating a better life that needs to happen. As South African government, enjoined by our constitution, we wish to state that we shall protect all people living in South Africa, nationals and non-nationals alike, and South African government continues to view the attacks on foreign nationals as a criminal offense that will not be tolerated. South Africa is a constitutional democracy governed by laws. Everyone working and living in the country must obey the laws in their totality. In the new constitution of this free and democratic South Africa, we made a promise to ourselves and to the world that we would remain committed to the values of human dignity, the achievement of equality, and the advancement of human rights and freedoms. Furthermore, at the core of our foreign policy is the commitment we have made to ourselves and to you that we will always prioritize Africa in all our endeavors, because we are an integral part of the African continent and must continue to live in peace and harmony with our brothers and sisters as one continent. Mr. President, in a focus and swift response to counter the tragic events of the past weeks, the government thus far responded by putting the following measures in place. Our President, President Zuma, has publicly condemned the unwarranted violent attacks on foreign nationals and the looting of their businesses, and has appealed for calm tolerance across the country. And this, I must add, honorable members, South Africans came in their numbers from all over the country to condemn these acts of violence masqueraded as xenophobic attacks. Because in our investigation, very soon after the attack, President Zuma sent all of us to different parts of this country to interact with everybody. It was clear that it is not xenophobic attacks. Because if it were xenophobic attacks, the acts that we saw would be all over the country. We realize that these acts are only happening where there's lots of unemployment, there's lots of poverty, and where our people see the competition for resources in the few people that made those areas their homes. So definitely, the South Africans are very clear that we are Africa, and we welcome our brothers and sisters that make this country their home. In addition to that, the President also established a panel of experts led by former Commissioner Navi Pillay of the Human Rights Council to advise the government on integration, proper integration of foreign nationals into local communities on an ongoing basis. The process of reintegration and displaced people is continuing. Most of those who still wanted to stay in South Africa have been integrated in those communities. Mr. President, the sixth session of the third Parliament convenes against this backdrop, and We've taken action. At first, we felt as South Africa, we must hang our head in shame because we always believe that we are because of the sacrifices that were made by many, in particular in this continent, assisting us in fighting for our liberation in South Africa. Mr. President, while we note these challenges, we cannot stop but acknowledge that we have also there have also been positive developments in the continent. We have recently witnessed successful elections where the will of the people was demonstrated freely. In this regard, allow me, Mr. President, to congratulate your own country and the people of Nigeria for your recently held peaceful elections. We hope that these recent election developments signal a new era in our continent, and the countries that are still to hold elections will observe the African Charter on Election, Politics and Governance, and more so, the will of the people. This august body must never tire to call and work for self-determination for the people of West Sahara. And we must support them in their realization of that goal. The Pan-African Parliament has worked very hard in this regard, and we urge you to continue to support the people of West Sahara. As South Africa, we remain steadfast in our support of the people of this sister country. In conclusion, Mr. President, we are aware that the mandate of the third parliament is coming to an end. We wish to congratulate you on your leadership of Pan-Africanist Parliament, African Parliament, that saw the adoption of the revised protocol. We hope that as a tribute to your work for the continent, member states will ratify the protocol and make it come into force. I know we've deliberated for a long time on this protocol, and I think member state, including our South Africa, needs to ratify and make it in force. We hope that this session will elect a bureau that will be sensitive to the needs of the African people and drive the work of this parliament forward. We wish you a successful election that will not preoccupy you and derail you from the continental programs at hand. We wish you a successful session, and it is our sincere hope that honorable members will have the necessary energy and zeal to fully participate in the 2-week-long activities, and we remain available to support. Let me reiterate, Honorable President and members, that as South Africa, we hoping, we know you will be discussing lots of resolutions. And we're hoping that we will benefit from the collective wisdom of this House. We're hoping that when you discuss some of the challenges, including the recent challenges in South Africa, you will realize that we also a young democracy that have challenges, and we depend on the continent to advise us, to show us the way, and collectively to realize that if we all solve our problems, the freedom and prosperity in South Africa and in all our countries and in the continent will prevail. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, Deputy Minister. We'll stand with you shoulder to shoulder in the fight against xenophobia. And we thank the government of South Africa for the efforts as we all would work together to unite our continent and the people of our continent. Honourable members, let me thank all those who have delivered messages of solidarity on your behalf for their very kind words and for their support for the growth and development of our continent. As is our tradition, we're expecting our guest of honor, His Excellency President Uhuru Kenyatta, President of the Republic of Kenya, who will be arriving here shortly, and will therefore suspend business to allow myself and members of the Bureau to receive our guest of honor. And during this short break, we would urge members of Parliament to stay within the chambers and the lobby so that we can resume as soon as our guest of honor arrives. I thank you and God bless you. Yeah.